they, and understanding their position, alter and determine particular political configurations. And we also, of course, need to know how the local and the national is mediated by the international. Your final observation earlier about the agribusiness.
Thank you, Ray. Have
you? Kareem Bakra, good Lord, Ozzy. Non, il m'a appelé il y a deux semaines ou quelque chose comme ça. Et il m'a dit, tu fais ça. Je ne suis pas une machine, moi, tu vois. Et donc, et en plus, le matin, devenir intelligent le matin, ça ne m'arrive jamais. C'est après-midi qu'il faut me demander de faire des choses. Éventuellement, je ne suis pas sûr. Je vais quand même essayer. J'avais préparé, au fait, malgré le challenge que Kalim m'a lancé, j'avais préparé quelque chose, mais si je devais le faire, ça prendrait une demi-heure, et je ne suis pas sûr que l'homme y soit d'accord. J'aurais voulu parler d'expérience, au fait. J'aurais voulu parler d'une expérience que je vais mentionner rapidement, mais vous pouvez parler avec moi après ou avec Rim, une expérience fantastique, deux expériences fantastiques qu'on a faites entre l'Égypte et la Tunisie. La première, c'est des groupes de jeunes chercheurs, General Scholars Group, qu'on a constitué de Tunisiens et d'Égyptiens pour les former aux sciences, pas les former, pardon la prétention, c'est vraiment trop prétendu, pour les habituer aux sciences sociales rurales. Et c'est une expérience absolument fantastique, tant pis pour vous, je n'aurai pas le temps de la raconter. Mais vous pouvez parler avec Yasmine Martez qui va intervenir cet après-midi, c'est notre fierté parce qu'elle était membre du General Scholars Group et maintenant docteur en anthropologie qui nous sort de Cambridge, excusez du peu. C'est une très belle expérience. Si vous avez des postes à Beyrouth, à Léoubi, vous avez une belle candidate. La deuxième expérience que j'aurais voulu vous raconter, c'est encore une autre expérience avec Lim, où on a organisé à Minia, à 300 km au sud du Caire, une rencontre entre des paysans tunisiens venus de Guèbe, 7 paysans, des femmes et des hommes qu'on a ramenés de Tunisie en Égypte et qui se sont rencontrés pendant 3 jours. Trois jours à Gebs, dont une journée de séminaire comme celle-là, où les universitaires n'avaient pas le droit de prendre la parole. Les paysans ont parlé entre eux de leurs problèmes et ils sont mis comme nous, comme ça, autour de la table. Ils étaient très beaux et parfois plus beaux que certains colloques scientifiques et surtout beaucoup plus intéressants. Et c'est une histoire fantastique, mais ça me prendrait franchement une heure. Sachez seulement que ça fait partie des choses qu'on devrait faire. J'aurais voulu vous parler, mais ça je vais prendre un peu de temps, si là il me donne 3 ou 4 minutes. Je viens d'une région non agricole dans le sens moderne du mot, mais c'est une région d'une richesse, d'un savoir-faire et de techniques et de technologies agricoles anciennes absolument extraordinaires. C'est situé en haut d'une petite montagne, d'une chaîne de montagnes dans le sud tunisien où il pleut à peu près 150 mm de pluie par an. Et c'est une région très aride et où vous avez quand même quelques oliviers qui se payent le luxe de produire jusqu'à 500 litres d'huile d'olive par olivier. Où on produit de l'orge, on produisait des figues, on produisait des raisins, on produisait des pastèques, on produisait des piments, on produisait donc ça va des légumes aux céréales en passant aux arbres et ainsi de suite. C'est un truc extraordinaire qui est en train de disparaître. Comme je n'ai pas le temps de vous la raconter, cette histoire-là, vous pouvez la voir dans un film qui est sur le site Thimar qui s'appelle Green Mirage, Sarab al-Akhdar ou les mirages verts selon la langue de votre choix. Je viens de cette région, donc pour moi l'agriculture c'était une corvée parce que je devais tenir les chèvres et aller ramasser les olives et tout ça. Et accidentellement, ça n'a jamais été un choix, je me suis trouvé dans un lycée agricole. Et donc je suis produit de cette école agricole Et de cette formation, je suis technicien agricole, technicien supérieur agricole, ingénieur en eau, sorti d'une école d'ingénieurs tunisienne. Et je dis souvent que si on m'avait donné à ce moment-là le ministère de l'Agriculture, j'aurais brûlé toute la Tunisie ancienne pour essayer de faire du neuf. Pourquoi ? Parce que c'est ce qu'on m'a appris. On m'a dit, ta maman, tu peux l'aimer, mais c'est du vieux, laisse tomber. On m'a dit, tes oliviers, tu peux les adorer, ça te rappelle tes enfants, ton enfance, mais c'est loin. Mais vous faites 25 mètres entre deux oliviers, c'est une perte de terrain, on me disait. Il faut faire 8 mètres et il faut irriguer les oliviers parce que ça va produire plus et on peut les traiter plus facilement. C'est comme ça qu'on forme les gens jusqu'à aujourd'hui dans les lycées et les écoles d'ingénieurs en Tunisie. Ça fait une petite différence avec le Maroc. L'école tunisienne, l'école dans le sens large, pas les NAT ou l'INRAT ou tel ou tel lycée, parce qu'il y en a un peu partout dans la région, mais l'école, le monde de l'éducation agricole en Tunisie, date à peu près de l'histoire coloniale. La Tunisie a été occupée en 81 et très vite, il va y avoir une structure de formation et qui va rester, qui va, l'héritage, c'est l'INAT, l'Institut National Agronomique Tunisien de Tunis, l'INRAT, un truc de recherche, et tous les lycées agricoles et tout ça. Ça formait des ouvriers et des experts et des techniciens intermédiaires et ainsi de suite. Mais pendant toute la période coloniale, la Tunisie a été indépendante en 56, en 57, ils sortaient de la promotion de l'ensemble des techniciens et ingénieurs qui sortaient de ces écoles coloniales. Il y avait, dans cette promotion, il y avait un Tunisien dans l'ensemble de la promotion. Et c'était le premier. 60 ans d'histoire de l'éducation, il y avait enfin en 57, et en 57, on était déjà indépendants. Et donc l'école a été basée dans l'idée de former les colons et les enfants de colons pour qu'ils s'accaparent la terre tunisienne. Et vous savez que la colonisation française, c'est une colonisation foncière, essentiellement. C'est l'occupation de la terre qui a intéressé les Français, c'est pas autre chose. Donc, et ça, c'est encore aujourd'hui. Et donc je sors de cette école-là et on m'envoie au ministère pour travailler. Que de technique, je ne savais pas quand on parlait de sociologie ou des choses comme ça, mais je disais, mais laisse tomber. Franchement, je lisais Marx parce que ça faisait sympa de lire Marx et sortir dans le café L'Univers. Il y a un café de gauchistes dans le centre-ville de Tunis. Et je disais, ouais, Marx, j'ai lu ça, super. Mais c'est juste pour pouvoir draguer les filles. Voilà. Franchement. Voilà.
You have been naughty all your life.
Voilà. Pardon. Donc.
C'est une maladie incurable.
Bon. Et bon, donc après, accidentellement aussi, je suis allé en France, là non plus, j'ai pas choisi, j'ai trouvé les sciences sociales, je me suis dit, mais merde, mais qu'est-ce que j'ai pas lu, qu'est-ce que je dois lire depuis. J'avais 30 ans de retard déjà, où j'avais pratiquement rien lu, je n'avais pas de formation en sciences sociales. Et on me donne, on me colle au département de géographie, on dit, ah ok, géographie, un peu de technique, c'est super, on va dessiner des cartes, des choses comme ça. Non, j'ai appris des choses en sciences sociales, et c'est là-bas que je me suis formé. Mais en même temps, c'est un autre problème, c'était encore pour moi, le mot colonial, c'est quand même resté encore même jusqu'à aujourd'hui un peu un blasphème en France. Mais je suis un issu, un produit de l'université française avec beaucoup de bons et quand même des structures mentales, enfin des structures de réflexion mentale. Qui me pose encore aujourd'hui un problème et c'est peut-être en train d'exploser et c'est le temps de prendre ma retraite, donc je vais certainement, parce que sinon je vais devenir méchant, d'autant plus que j'enseigne et c'est vraiment pas sympa pour les étudiants. Bon, je suis en train de vivre une dernière expérience et je promets j'aurai arrêté. Jusqu'en 2011, c'était franchement, vivre en Tunisie avant 2011, prétendre faire de la recherche, quel que soit le domaine, mais plus ou moins sciences sociales, plus ou moins, c'était un challenge. c'était un risque énorme. Beaucoup de gens ont péri en prison parce qu'ils ont écrit des petits morceaux d'articles où ils ont trouvé intelligent de mettre une idée à gauche ou à droite. Donc la recherche était, dans les meilleurs des cas, strictement technique. On a de très bons collègues, comme je suis plutôt critique, je ne vais pas forcément donner tous les noms, mais qui se sont révélés brillants, y compris en proposant des lectures plus liées aux sciences sociales, plus critiques, après 2011. Et ça, je cite Mohamed Adloum, si on a un exemple. Ce qu'il a écrit avant 2011, c'était essentiel, très limité. Il faisait passer quelque chose entre les lignes, mais il n'osait pas. Et quand il sortait tout seul. Quand il partait à l'étranger, parfois il disait quelque chose, mais à condition qu'il n'y ait pas la caméra en face. Et c'était horrible. Et donc, pour nous, la recherche et l'éducation, la formation des paysans et des jeunes et des techniciens, c'est quelque chose de nouveau dans sa dimension ouverte sur les sciences sociales. Et c'est ça le fond et un gain énorme de ce qu'on a appelé la révolution, malgré toutes les déceptions. C'est aujourd'hui, on peut aller sans visa et sans demander une autorisation spéciale. Le matin, je prends ma voiture ou la voiture de quelqu'un et je vais dans la campagne. Je n'ai pas peur que les flics m'arrêtent, je n'ai pas peur, je peux filmer, je peux parler avec les paysans. Et j'ai découvert des professeurs absolument extraordinaires. Et c'est ces professeurs-là que j'ai ratés pendant toute ma vie. C'est les paysans, et pour moi, mes meilleurs professeurs ont été des paysans. Voilà.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Habib. I think that was a very moving account of your evolution as a product of the colonial French colonial educational system that geared young Tunisians towards entering the modern agricultural production world at the expense of the old farming systems that themselves were very productive, as you implied. I'll just put this in a few words, really, and I think it's worth talking to Habib later about the details of the experience. But in a few words, I think that Habib's epiphany came when, as a technical agriculture water engineer, he discovered social sciences, which complemented for him as a professor in agriculture, complemented fully his technical approach and shed light on the dangers of following a purely technical, colonially driven approach towards harnessing the resources of the land for agricultural production. I think I'm glad I was able to put this in a few words. The last part of the intervention was about the changes that have occurred in Tunisia after 2011, in which social scientists have now the ability to, without any constraints, to reach out to farmers and establish a mutually learning relationship with the farmers, which Habib thinks will contribute, has changed him personally, and hopefully will contribute to changing the face of the sector. Am I right? Okay. I want to say a couple of words, but not too much. And I would like to anchor what we're saying here into a pragmatic vision that I don't think is going to be extremely popular, but yet I still am going to do that. I just want to remind ourselves that in spite of all these new exciting times in which social sciences is interacting with the technical science, etc., the reality is still that the agriculture sector in our region here is in dismay. And that's a reality. There is nothing to be happy about with that. The share of agriculture as a productive economic sector in the GDP is in constant decline. And every year it is worse than the year that comes before. We may disagree with what GDP is, etc. This is a reality. Agriculture as a, as an economic sector is not doing very well. The cost of social reproductions for families of peasants involved in agriculture are far too big. It is not possible, unless you have a very large piece of land and you have access to technology, to live decently from agriculture. There is a two-tier system that is being established between people who live in urban area with access to resources, to services, to schooling, to hospitals, to health, and those who do not have the choice but to remain in rural areas and to work the land. That is also a reality. The yield gap that exists in our countries, then the yield gap is the potential yield of any crop and the actual production, which is represented in terms of value and in terms of money at the end of the day. I know in the social sciences we don't like very much to talk about money and about capital and about returns and about investment, but these are realities that people, the peasants, face every day. At the end of every month, they still have to pay for doctors, for schools, for cars, and they need to do that. So these are in decline. It is not possible to live off farming. Trust me, I try. With the hectare of land that I plant, I can barely pay the cost of the hectare itself, the cost of production. I would need another couple of hectares and some more investment money to be able to start making a little bit of money. So this is a difficulty. This is creating what Ray has just termed a peasantariat, and I like the term because it represents very much what it actually is. And people are not even proletarized; they're lumpenized because they lose access to some means of production and they have nothing with that. And on top of all of this, we are becoming increasingly import dependent as nations. These are realities, absolute, complete realities. So my question is, of course, how did agriculture, education in our countries contribute to this situation? And I think Habib has shed some light on that. And I do agree with the fact with the implication was. I mean, if I understood well, the implication was that education, and something that we all know, is not neutral. It serves to support an economic system that is being implemented. It is not neutral that we learn to become specialists in areas rather than all-rounders in the field of farming and of food and fiber production. That the people who are trained, as you said, in your generation too, were people who could go and talk to farmers, but not be farmers themselves. That we actually, through education, created a class of technocrats of farming, people who are not directly involved in the economic production sector, but who offered services to a sector that is dwindling and going away. And I think this needs to be addressed. It needs to be understood. The productivism is based on a type of Fordism in which every person does a little bit, and that in which one person as a technical agent cannot go out and produce, contribute to the productive. I am adamant on insisting on production. And the people we train in the universities can hardly go and do that. That is left to the peasants, and then we go and talk to the peasants, and now we want to go and learn from them. That's perfectly fine. Learning from them is a very enjoyable process. But by doing that, do we contribute to improving the existence of the farmer, not our existence, the existence of the people who have selected agrarianism as a way? How do we contribute to dismantling this class system that has been created by an education that is geared towards urban people or urbanized in the rural? They're urbanized in the rural, who talk to farmers and try to help them. This is the important part that we need to look into. Until we start forming people who feel comfortable in going out and investing themselves and what they have into becoming part of the productive economy, then agricultural education will still be lagging behind. This is what, in my opinion, we should be aiming at. And this, by the way, also explains your generation three, why we're trying to get people to get jobs. Because in reality, even in most universities, enrollment in agriculture major is declining scaringly. And I'm not going to give you numbers because that would scare you, but it is declining because whoever wants to invest in agriculture education does not feel armed or able to go out and actually put into practice this social asset that they have, this human asset that they have built, in order to construct a decent livelihood. And what else do we want? The first thing we want is to be able to construct a decent livelihood. I will give you the floor now. Rima, did you want to be talking also after? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You might know that Yemen, from ancient times, it is a land of agriculture. And you might know also the story of the Marib Dam and the destruction of the dam and deterioration of the old civilization at that at Marib. Yemeni people have had always been a sustainable water management system and used it very carefully for agriculture activities. Only in the early 80s from the last century, Sana'a University, for example, started opening in a faculty of agriculture. So, and even the Ministry of Agriculture and Irrigation is relatively a new ministry, only established after the revolution of 1962. And academic or education on agriculture and training and education in general is, let us say, very new. The Faculty of Agriculture, as you have just said right now, that nowadays and we have much more teaching stuff than we have students, and because they don't get jobs, the graduates of the Faculty of Agriculture. We have also other related educational centers in Yemen, and also at Sana'a University, as I said before, the Water and Environment Center, in short WEC, is educating students and also the public in water management, in agriculture, technology, and providing knowledge in these fields, and trying to do its best to develop the country. And this has been done through the with the help of foreign aid, and let us say the WEC is being supported mainly by the Dutch government and by Dutch universities, let us say, which is Wageningen University and Delft University mainly, who are very famous for their agriculture education and knowledge. And the teaching stuff there at the Faculty of Agriculture and the WEC also, they're trying to have close correlation with the sector, the public sector, with the Ministry of Agriculture and Integration, and also with the Ministry of Water and Environment, and to for better water management, because the water level in Yemen is generally decreasing about 6 meters a year. And agriculture in Yemen is mainly private, not public. So farmers just using and withdrawing consuming huge quantities of water on a daily basis. I would not talk about what crops they are planting, but in general, it is a dilemma. Now, how to convince the farmers to use much more modern technologies to decrease the water consumption for agriculture? I mean, many solutions have been just formulated, but the question is always being raised if there is the willingness from the state also to enforce their laws and to keep agriculture activities as they are, or to decrease these activities. What is better for Yemen, to waste all the remaining water we still have, or just to change to industry, or what to do? I mean, it's trying to use desalination of seawater. We have enough seawater, but desalination is very expensive. To what extent are we able to transport this water to agricultural areas in Yemen? In our agricultural areas are mainly in the Tahama and in Tahama and the mid highlands of Yemen. So it is very expensive to transport this. It's also risky to transport this water to these areas. And it is not easy to convince farmers, which are used to have all of farmers, or mostly all of them, they have weapons with them. When they come to the WEC to get some training, they have always they are carrying their weapons with them. You can't even tell them, lay them aside. I mean, until now, we did not have any struggles within Sana'a University in this regard, but it keeps it challenging to educate people or farmers which are armed. Another challenge is also now, as I told you before, that we have this educational program at the WEC, which is called Integrated Water Resources Management, and we have this is a multidisciplinary program. The background of our students is very different. We have people from the natural sciences, from the Faculty of Engineering, from the Faculty of Agriculture, from social sciences, from pure natural sciences. And in the first year, actually on the first semester, we try to bring them on the same level of, to some extent, to on the same level of education, so that those people from natural sciences get an insight to social sciences, and also those people who have studied biology, that they get an insight to what is water engineering about, and what is agriculture about, and which is also quite a great challenge. But I mean, it is an I think it is a good way to try to solve our problems in the agriculture and water sector in Yemen. And but now some of our students, and I myself, I face many challenges to to use the methodologies of social sciences, where I'm actually pure natural scientist. So I'm facing in kind of methodology to how to contact people, how to do surveys, how to analyze the data, how to also relate the data together. And this program, this master program, is actually it is solution oriented. So we also have to try to find solution. Then we have to find the social aspects and participatory aspects of the community and link them to technical aspects. And all these are great challenges for all of us who work in this field. We are still struggling a lot and trying to figure out also the new terminology we are exposed to as natural scientists. It's just amazing. I have to translate so many words on a daily basis to figure out what does it mean. Those are main challenges we are facing. I think,
Thank you. Thank you very much. I thank you, because I wanted to add a couple of words on behalf of Amin Al-Hakimi from an email he sent us. And as I remind you, Amin was not allowed to leave Sana'a because of the blockade that's being imposed by the Saudi-led coalition on Yemen. And so Amin says, I'm going to read it all. It's actually quite touching. My apologies for the delay in responding due to the internet problem in my area in Sana'a. I'm sorry to be absent at the event at AUB due to the closure of the Sana'a airport. Concerning the roundtable discussion, the comment that I would like to add is the particularity of Yemeni agriculture and its solid link to the Eastern African ecological zone, the absence of any effort in training exchange, and the importance to get involved in collaborations to adapt more technical and practical interdisciplinary training, since the similarities on ecological, biological, and historical events involved in crops, evolutions, and trading. So I think the gist here is that there is a specificity that makes Yemen closer to the Eastern African ecological zone, and that this needs to be reinforced. Knowledge needs to be exchanged, with this being kept in mind. So this was from Dr. Amin Al-Hakimi from Sana'a University too. Rima.
Oh. Wow, what can I say? The senior scholars in the network are a very tough lead to follow, so I'm nearly speechless. Reflecting back on the issue that was raised by Ray Bush in his earlier intervention, the issue of interdisciplinarity, I can tell you that I am the boring person, health person in the group, who's trying to remind everybody of incorporating health and well-being in their research and in their approach. So I keep on saying, please remember the health and well-being of farmers and farm workers, what impacts their health, take into consideration the environmental exposures, the linkages between human health, well-being, and the environment, health insurance, health coverage, what impacts that, what are the policies that are put